morning, everyone, and welcome to another edition of Insure Talk. Today we are on number 43, the 20th of June. Yesterday we saw the inauguration of our president. There is a sense of hope, I would say, in the air in South Africa, and it's really wonderful to watch how things are unfolding in the political landscape. And then, of course, investment stock market is doing extremely well. The rand improved quite considerably against the dollar. So overall, things are looking quite positive for South Africans right now. So we're very happy to have you here this morning. And our theme conference today is Future Forward, Embracing Innovation, Neuroscience, and Youth Perspectives in the Evolving Insurance Landscape. So we're covering a wide variety of topics today. And as always, we are very, very excited to have you with us around this virtual roundtable. We expect to welcome a good few thousand people today, and looking forward to our program and lineup. But before we start with the program, I want to thank our headline event sponsor today. It's a very special sponsor and very close to my heart. It's Elite Risk Acceptances. And I say special not for the obvious reasons. I say it because here at InsureTalk, the team that sits behind InsureTalk, they also host in-person events, or they organize in-person events. Of course, they do the African Insurance Exchange. And they recently hosted the Elite Wealth Conference, which was a hybrid conference. And Elite has been a partner of the team at CN&Co and InsureTalk almost from the beginning. Well, in fact, I think it was from the beginning. So a very special partner for us to have today. I just wanted to quickly tell you about Elite. So Elite is a specialist, a personal lines, high net worth underwriter. They're part of the Old Mutual Group, Old Mutual Insure Group. And they offer personalized and tailored solutions for short-term insurance and personal risk management for people with sophisticated needs. And as part of the Old Mutual Insure family, of course, the Old Mutual Group, 180 years old, lots of experience in insurance, we are very excited and honored to have a friend of the show, a friend of mine, and also the managing director of Elite here today to speak to us on a very interesting topic. So she says, AOL, is that the same as LOL? LOL. Adapting to the future, understanding Gen Z preferences in the workplace. So Tarina Flock is going, I just want to tell you a little bit about her. She is the managing director and co-founder of Elite, and she works with a highly competent team in this specialist space in our market. She's got a legal background, but she joined the non-life insurance industry 22 years ago. She's a member of the Insurance Institute of Directors of South Africa. She loves traveling, reading, binge-watching Netflix, and spending time with friends and family, and she loves a good glass of wine. Wonderful mother, wonderful friend, and leader in our industry. Tarina, over to you.
Oh, thanks so much for the lovely introduction, Christelle, and thanks for having me this morning. We recently, just on Monday, I'm just trying to put up the slides for you to see. We celebrated Youth Day. So I thought, why not gain some insights into the work expectations of those latest entrants to the job market, Gen Z. A few years ago, I did some research about the work expectations of millennials, and that exercise was eye-opening. So as I am a baby boomer, I'm getting ready to exit the corporate employment. I thought it's a good idea to look at the next generation and see how we as employers need to adapt to continue to attract and retain this bright young talent. As we navigate the 21st century, it's important that we recognize...
Sorry, Tarina, I'm Llewellyn here. I just want to stop you. I see your screen hasn't shared. If you can just reshare for us, please.
Oh, apologies.
No problem at all.
Perfect. Is it sharing
thank
now?
You so much. Yes, thank you so much.
My sincere apologies to everyone. So, what I was saying, as we navigate the 21st century, it's important that we recognize and respond to the evolving needs and expectations of our workforce. Generation Z, or Gen Z, as the Americans call them, are those born between 1997 and 2012, and they're entering the workforce in increasing numbers. In fact, it's predicted that by next year, between 27 and 30% of the workforce will be Gen Zs. Their unique perspectives and preferences necessitate a re-evaluation of our traditional workplace structures and practices. To effectively engage with Gen Z, we must first understand how they differ from the generations before them, their core characteristics and values, and how we can appropriately meet their needs in the workplace. This generation has grown up in an era of rapid technological advancement, economic uncertainty, and a heightened awareness of global issues. These experiences have shaped their expectations and preferences in distinct ways. Gen Z is the first generation to grow up entirely in the digital age, and they have no concept of life without smartphones and internet. They are adept at using technology, and it's this tech savvy and dependency which sets them apart from other generations. They expect seamless digital integration in the workplace. The world of Gen Z has been defined by technological changes happening at rapid speed that also reshaped social experiences. Disruption and impermanence have always been part of the world of Gen Z. For them, it's a norm, not an exception. They expect constant change. Growing up amidst uncertainty has given them a unique set of characteristics, including being flexible and resilient. It has opened them up to new ways of thinking about the future, doing things, and questioning the way things are done. This generation places a high value on ethical behavior, corporate social responsibility, and sustainability. Because they grew up in an interconnected, globalized world of endless possibility, they have high expectations from their employers to address social and environmental issues. They prefer to work for companies that align with their values and contribute positively to society. This incidentally aligns strongly with the sentiments of millennials, who expect companies to put their money where their mouth is. They expect business to authentically align to these values and can see through window dressing very easily. They are increasingly willing to reject assignments or employers who don't align with their values. When employers take that feedback and respond positively, employee loyalty tends to be much higher. Purpose is subjective, but it boils down to working for an organization who has a purpose beyond profit and is having a positive impact on society. Environmental sustainability remains a top concern for Gen Zs, and they even feel anxious or worried about climate change. They also actively research the environmental practices of companies they purchase from, and they are willing to pay more for sustainable products. Although work remains central to their sense of identity, Gen Z value friends and family, explaining why work-life balance, flexible working conditions, and mental well-being are very important to them. Work-life balance remains top of their list of priorities when choosing an employer. It's also the most admired trait amongst their peers. They place value on the human experience and recognizing that life is more than work. All studies indicate this as one of their most important values, and that they will easily leave employment if they cannot find that balance. Work stress contributes to mental health issues. Gen Zs indicate in studies that they feel stressed all or most of the time. This is driven by financial concerns, family welfare, but also by job-related factors such as long working hours and lack of recognition. The key learning here is that employers need to address the concerns of discrimination in the event of sharing mental health issues. We need to address this stigma through transparency about our own mental health experiences and prioritizing mental health in the workplace. Gen Z also want to determine their own career path, and they want flexibility to change it at any time to develop their skills and promote lifelong learning. They value flexible work, both in terms of when and where they work. This drive for greater flexibility seems to be increasing the popularity for less traditional employment models. For example, they would like employers to create more part-time jobs and job-sharing options and ensure that employees who work part-time have comparable career advancement opportunities to full-time employees. Of course, they would also like a four-day work week for full-time employees. Continuous learning and career development are crucial for Gen Z. They are attracted to employers who offer opportunities for growth, skills development, and clear career progression. In fact, most of them expect it from their employers. So what can we as employers do to attract and retain these leaders of tomorrow? Number one, let's embrace technology. As digital natives, it's no surprise that Gen Z expects a workplace that leverages technology to enhance productivity and collaboration. According to Deloitte's Global Millennial and Gen Z survey, 91% of Gen Z respondents believe that a company's technology influences their job choice. Employers should invest in modern tools and platforms that facilitate remote work, virtual meetings, and efficient communication. Providing access to cutting-edge technology not only boosts productivity, but also demonstrates a commitment to innovation, which is highly valued by Gen Z and imperative for a sustainable future. So, how do companies achieve this? Ensure that the organization has a robust digital infrastructure. This includes high-speed internet, secure cloud storage, and collaboration tools like Zoom and MS Teams. These tools must not only be user-friendly, but also regularly updated to keep up with technological advancements. Encourage digital literacy by offering training programs to enhance literacy among employees. This not only empowers them to use new tools effectively, but also fosters a culture of continuous learning. Implement automation to handle repetitive tasks. This allows employees to focus on more meaningful and creative work, which is highly appreciated by those who seek purpose in their roles. Secondly, promote ethical practices and sustainability. Gen Z not only expect change, they demand it. They are inheriting a set of complex problems, from climate change to inequality to racial injustice, and they want to fix it. They want to work for a place that they believe is doing good in the world. Corporate social responsibility is a significant factor in Gen Z's employment decisions. Forbes reports that 77% of them are concerned about the environmental impact of their actions. Companies must adopt and communicate their commitment to ethical practices and sustainability. This includes transparent reporting on environmental impact, fair labor practices, and community engagement. By aligning business operations with these values, employers can attract Gen Z employees who are passionate about making a difference. They are also less hierarchical than previous generations. They don't believe in hierarchy for hierarchy's sake, but only where it's useful. They prefer leadership that is dependent on task or time-specific expertise. That could mean they favor rotating leadership where team members take turns leading the group, or collaborative leadership where people from across the organization participate in decision-making and problem-solving. Transparency is also important. They highly value consensus and prefer servant leadership and authenticity. Employers need to stay open to hearing about different ways of getting things done because this generation has has one foot firmly in the future. Thirdly, offer flexible working arrangements. Flexibility in work schedules and locations is essential to meet Gen Z's desire for work-life balance. Deloitte's survey indicates that 75% of them consider flexibility as a top priority when choosing an employer. Employers should consider implementing flexible working hours, remote work options, and comprehensive wellness programs. These measures not only enhance employee satisfaction, but also improve retention rates and productivity. Consider that many of Gen Z entered the workforce just as the COVID-19 pandemic reached its peak. That period saw the blurring of the 9-to-5 work schedule and the rise of flexible work models, a mode of working that led to older generations feeling pressure to always be on. However, it seems like Gen Z is sensitive to the risk of an integrated work and home life and working all the time. I've seen in many a job interview that inflexibility with work arrangements is often a deal breaker for these youngsters. It's important for employers to consider hybrid work models that combine remote work with office presence. This provides flexibility while maintaining team cohesion. Also, allow employees to choose their working hours within a set range. This accommodates different lifestyles and peak productivity times. Also, implement wellness programs that include mental health support, fitness classes, and stress management workshops. A holistic approach to employee well-being is crucial. Then offer continuous learning and development. For Gen Z, personal and professional growth is extremely important, and they expect their employers to provide professional development opportunities. Studies have shown that young people are seeking education and skills development outside institutions of higher education. Many Gen Zs believe that higher education should evolve to better prepare young people for the rapidly changing nature of work. So, employers must supplement higher education with learning and development opportunities, particularly as rapidly evolving technologies make lifelong learning even more essential. Employers should give sufficient opportunities for skills development, training, and career advancement. This can be achieved through mentorship programs, online courses, workshops, and clear pathways for career progression. I'm sorry about the dog's sound in the background. Employers who change how they attract, hire, develop, and retain talent and foster personal development will not only attract Gen Z talent, but also ensure that the workforce remains competitive and adaptable. Excuse me. Develop an inclusive and collaborative culture. According to research, Gen Zs are more racially and ethnically diverse than any other generation before it. A diverse and inclusive workplace is therefore highly attractive to them. A survey by Deloitte finds that 80% of Gen Z respondents believe that an inclusive workplace is important when choosing an employer. They are a generation that expects equity, inclusion, and a sense of belonging. This group of young adults tend to focus on the integrity of work as it fits into their personal value system. They are a more socially conscious generation whose life has been characterized by 9/11, a recession, and a global pandemic. They consider whether or not their workplace aligns with their personal values and empowers employees. Employers must cultivate a culture that values diversity and promotes inclusion. This involves creating policies that support equal opportunities, encourage diverse perspectives, and foster a sense of belonging. Additionally, a collaborative work environment that encourages teamwork and open communication will resonate with these employees who value connectivity and cooperation. A business that succeeds in attracting this bright young talent has to integrate a workforce made up of four generations, each with their own unique style, needs, goals, and characteristics. It's very important to create an environment of belonging where everyone feels valued for what they bring to the table. This, of course, requires an open and transparent working environment where employees of all ages can thrive, work together, and learn from each other. In conclusion, the preferences of Generation Z are reshaping the dynamics of the modern workplace. As employers, it's our responsibility to adapt and create environments that are conducive to the needs and aspirations of this emerging generation. By embracing technological integration, promoting ethical practices, offering flexibility, investing in continuous learning, and fostering an inclusive culture, we can attract and retain the best Gen Z talent. The future of work is evolving, and by aligning our practices with the values of this generation, we not only ensure our relevance, but also pave the way for a more dynamic, innovative, and resilient workforce. It's not easy to get every one of these things right. It requires employees to constantly listen and adjust their strategies, but those who do get it right will have a more satisfied, productive, engaged, and agile workforce who are much better prepared to adapt to a transforming world. And that's it. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you, Tarina. I think sometimes we want to loll at the IOLs we see in insurance, but that was a very insightful delivery there. And we appreciate you making the time and the preparation that you've clearly done to talk to us here today. So again, thank you to Elite Risk Acceptances, part of the Old Mutual Group, Old Mutual Insure. And Tarina, you and your team for supporting us here at Insure Talk so wonderfully over the years. Our next speaker is also sponsored by Elite as part of our headline event sponsorship for the day. It is an individual called Dr. Kobus Oosthuizen. He's got a very interesting topic, and I can't actually wait to hear what this is about. His topic is excellence and the influence of neuroscience on thinking. And I just want to give you a little bit of a background as to who Dr. Kobus Oosthuizen is. He is known by many as the mind bender. He travels the globe teaching people how incredible their mind is and how to use it to navigate change and optimize performance, helping companies to set up and create a positive, high-level company culture and leading teams to that function at peak performance while loving what they do is his passion. He's internationally known as a dynamic and entertaining speaker, which is good to know. And he's an expert in his field and a facilitator of sustainable change. So we're going to listen now to excellence and the influence of neuroscience on thinking. So over to Dr. Oosthuizen on this fascinating topic.
Oh, thank you, Christelle. Really, really appreciate it. And it's awesome to be with you from a very cold Cape Town. I'm sitting in this little studio of mine, freezing to death. But it is It is so cool. And I so wish, I mean, the one thing that I can't get out of this webinar is to see how many Gen Zs are we speaking to right now? That will be fascinating. But thanks, Irina. I so enjoyed your input as well. Guys, normally I spend like, let's say, a year with a group of people. I've never in my life only had 35 minutes. So I'm going to just jump in and show you the coolest thing that you've ever seen in your entire life. But before you do that, Before I show you this most beautiful thing ever, I quickly want you to go to the chat function on your screen, which you are clearly enjoying as I see all the thank yous coming through for Tarina. And I want you to quickly go and get my name, all right? So Kobus Oosthuizen, skip the doctor part. So if you go to 2 and you click most likely at the top around where the panelists are, you will find my name. And I quickly want you to select my name and just send me a direct message. Just say, hey, hi, bye, whatever you want to say. I just want to make sure that I can get a direct message from you. Cool. Thank you. All right. I want to show you the coolest thing ever. Let me just show you this picture. This is it. This is what I get out of bed in the morning. Just want to make sure you can see my screen. Here comes my picture. Oh, yellow. This is it. Let me just quickly tell you. You were born with 100 billion of these things. You know what it is, by the way. I've heard some weird and strange remarks as to what people think this is. But so let me just tell you. You were born with 100 billion neurons in your brain. And what you're seeing on your screen right now is actually a neuron. It is that bright part there in the middle is the neuron in your brain. Now, you see all those dendrites. By the way, I tell people that you were born with 100 billion of these things. And they go like, oh, that's nice. That sounds good. I'm like, no, you've got no idea. You've got no idea how many that is. So let me maybe just help you out with your mathematics, with your numbers this morning. You all know a million, right? All right. Now, if we take a million and we count backwards a million seconds, we will get to 12 days. Take a million divided by 24 hours, divided by 60 minutes, divided by 60 seconds, and you get 11.57 something. A million seconds ago is 12 days ago. A billion seconds ago, what do you think? Now, let me help you out. A billion seconds ago will take you back to March 1985, all right? So there's a big difference between a million and a billion. 100 billion seconds ago will take you back to 1,250 years BC. You were born with 100 billion of these things. Oh man, that is just incredible. I look at people and I'm like, if they only can understand what a genius they are already. Now, by the way, you don't have to go to the gym to get this. You don't have to go on a diet to get it. You've got this right now. Now, if that isn't remarkable enough, each neuron in your brain can build, you see all those networks there, those neural pathways, each neuron can build up to 400,000 of these connections, which means each neuron can store up to 400,000 pieces of information. Now, I'm not going to do that, Sam. You can take 100 billion times 400,000 to figure out your personal brain capacity right now. But maybe to frame this for you, if you come to me and you say, Kobus, can you fill my mind with information until it's full? I'll have to put you on a drug or something, and then I'll give you information every second for the rest of your life, day and night. And after 4 million years, you will go like, ah, it's full. It's full now. It will take me 4 million years to fill your brain with information. Isn't that crazy? By the way, we wanted to figure out how much brain capacity do you need to pass grade 12 in our country? And so what we had to do is, we know you've got 100 billion brain cells. We know you can store up to 400,000 pieces of information. And so all we had to do is to figure out how much information do you need to recall in grade 12? That was what we had to figure out. So we started counting. We said, well, this is a grasshopper. That's one piece of information. It's got a little antenna. That's another piece of information. And after counting all the information in grade 12, we got to about 250,000 pieces of information is what a grade 12 student needs to recall, all right? So if you think about it, what does this mean when it comes to how much brain capacity a grade 12 student needs? It's got 100 billion brain cells. He only needs to recall, each brain cell can recall 400,000 pieces of information. There's only 250,000 pieces of information to recall in grade 12. How much brain capacity does he need? Do you know? Want to give it a go? You're most likely right. Not even one brain cell. Not even one brain cell to get through grade 12. That's what we know today. And you are sitting with 100 billion brain cells right now. Man, that is just incredible. You are sitting as a full-on genius. Well, often people tell me, Curvis, I don't always feel like a genius. I know. There's a part of the brain that I want to show you that will really help you to understand how to unleash more of your genius. All right. So let me quickly, we're going to play a little bit, you know, maybe do a bit of activity for me to establish where your mind is at. So what I want you to do now is I'm going to put a sentence on the screen, and all I want you to do is to read that sentence for me. All right. So let's just read this sentence together. Here we go. It says, finished files are the result of years of scientific study combined with the experience of many years of experts. All right. So you can all read it. I mean, it's displayed on your screen, right? Okay. So what I want you to do now is I'm going to ask you to read that sentence again. And then I want you to go to the chat box. You know, you're still chatting to me, right? So I want you to go to the chat box. I want you to count how many F's do you see in that sentence, and just type the number into the chat box for me, all right? And then you just send me that number, okay? I'll count us in. I'll say 3, 2, 1, and then you all press enter, and we might bomb Zoom out. I don't know, but let's try, okay? So here's the sentence. Just quickly count how many F's do you find in the sentence? Go to the chat box, select my name, and then you send me your number. I'll count you in when to press enter. Okay, I see a few coming through. I like it. Okay, there's a lot coming through. All right. It seems like most of you got this. Most of you got this. So I'm quickly going to give you feedback as to what I'm seeing on my screen. I would say the bulk of the information coming through right now sits at about 2 F's. If we have to vote about the answer, it seems like 2 F is the majority, followed by 3 F's. That is what's coming through. I see a couple of 5's, loads of 4's coming through. I even see a few 6's. Oh, there's a 7, a few 7's that I'm seeing coming through. A couple of 7's and more 2's. All right, you can stop now. You can stop now. Let me help you out. Ladies and gentlemen, there are 7 F's in that sentence. 7 F's in that sentence. Let me just help you out. Finished 1, files 2, are the result of 3, of 4, scientific 5, and then looked at the last sentence of 6, years of experts, 7 F's. 7 F's. Most of you gave me 2 and 3. I see a lot of 7's coming in now at the end. Now that I've given you the answer, thank you very much. You had one choice, one chance. Oh, that was my question. Susanna, I just wanted to ask, what did you miss? And you just said, I missed the F's, the ofs. Now, why would you miss the ofs? They are so obvious. I'll tell you what, we're going to come back to this. I'll explain to you in a second why you might have missed some of those ofs. Let's do something else. How is your mathematics? Okay, now we are going to do a standard grade maths literacy sum. Okay, I mean, this is so, I want to show you what side of your brain is active while we're doing this. All right, so this is so standard. So you're not going to sit there with a calculator and work this out. That will be embarrassing. You're not going to write this down on a piece of paper. That will be embarrassing. You're just going to do it in your head, and then you're going to type the answer for me in the chat box. Remember, you're sending it to me. Nobody else is seeing it. So you can, you know, relax. So you're just going to do this in your head. All right. I want to show you what side of your brain is active. So here we go. I mean, it's so easy. It's like 1,000 plus 20. You can do that, right? Okay, cool. So here we go. Be ready to give me your answer in the chat box. So we've got 1,000, 1,020, 2,020. That's 2,050. That is 3,050. That is 3,090. That's 4,090. I'm going to add a last number. There's your last number. Quickly add it up. Send me the answer in the chat box. They're all coming through. I see a gazillion 5,000. It seems like We've got some good mathematicians in this group. Thousands are coming through. It seems like the majority, there's a few, I saw a few 6,000s. 5,000 is the dominant number. I see a couple of 4,100s coming through. Okay. So this is what I got from you. Thank you for that. This is what I got. It seems like the majority of you, there was a 16,000 something that I just saw flying through there. I want to invest with you, wherever you were. Return on investment seems good. It seems like in the majority, I got 5,000 coming through. There were a few 5,100s. I saw a 6,000. I saw quite a few 4,100s as well. But definitely, if I have to put my money on the winner here, it will be 5,000. Now, ladies and gentlemen, the answer is not 5,000, by the way. The answer is actually, LOL, Donkey Zelda, for probably fixing your mistake. It's 4,100. The answer is not 5,000. It is 4,100. 1,000 plus 20 is 1,020, 2,020, 2,050, 3,050, 3,090, 4,090. 90 plus 10 is how much? 90 plus 10 is 100. It's not 1,000. So the answer must be 4,100, not 5,000. But you know what? It is early in the morning. I know, maybe math is not your thing. Let's do something else quickly. I'm going to flash a picture to you for 3 seconds. And I just want you to type in the text box or the chat box to me. What did you see? Okay, so I'm going to flash this picture for you. You send to me. What do you see? Here we go. 3, 2, 1. I'm going to take it away and I'm going to just spend a few seconds. Oh, there's a lot coming through. Ducks. There's a lot of ducks or birds. Blue bird, duck. Then there's rabbits and bunnies. Rabbits. Oh, I saw somebody said, what was that? Oh, my word. Okay, cool. More ducks. Bunnies, rabbits, birds, duckling, duck rabbit. There's a squirrel as well. There's a dolphin. Wilhelm said, Ritter, we are still trying to do research on people like you, all right? We don't know how people see that dolphin, but we're still trying to figure that out. Fascinating what people see when I put that up. Rabbits, bunnies. Okay, so it seems definitely that the dominant view there is either a duck or a bunny. Some people also saw squirrels. And then obviously it seems like, there's a dinosaur. There's a dinosaur as well. Okay, so it seems like people see different things. Now, for all of you that saw the duck or the bird, quickly going to see if I can, without messing anything up for my beautiful host. Okay, and I'm not going to play around with, see if I can get my little spotlight. Let's see. No, okay, don't worry. But if it's the duck or the bird, it's looking to the left-hand side on my screen with a beak facing to the ceiling and the eye looking up. And then if you come down the body, the front part will be the foot and the back part will be the tail feathers on the right-hand side. If you want to see the bunny or the duck, then the bunny or the rabbit or maybe the squirrel as well, then you will have to look to the right-hand side. You know, the bunny is looking to the right-hand side on your screen. The duck's beak is actually the bunny ears sticking back to the back. He's also looking up. And if you go back from his bunny ears at the top, you will see his round tail and you will see his leg in front. All right. Now, somebody also sees a snail. That's also beautiful. Now, for those of you that saw snails and dolphins and so on, since they legalized dacha in this country, people see all sorts of weird things. So I can't comment on how you see this. But anyway, so duck, bunny, rabbit, that is kind of what I see people are seeing. So let's do a last one. Now, I want you to listen carefully to the question. Listen very carefully to the question. I've got two cards in my hand. And what I want you to do is I want you to look at which card seems to be, looks like, is the question, the taller or the bigger card. And you can just type in right or left. Would you say this one or this one? Which one seems to be, is perceived, looks like, is the question, right or left? Now, I get a lot of lefts. I got the same, mostly left on the screen. Okay, cool. Now you, I mean, you know, I know that you know that they're exactly the same size, but this is what I want to show you. Even if you know that they're exactly the same size, your brain will not allow you to see that they're exactly the same size. So you can know that they're exactly the same size, but your brain will not allow you to see that they're exactly the same size. Now, I see somebody is saying on the screen, depth perception, and normally I would go and give you the cost. I'm not using depth perception at the moment. So I want to just assure you that I'm not playing with distances between the cards. I'm keeping them next to each other. In fact, it doesn't matter on what side I hold this card. This one would look taller than the other one. All right, what's happening with me? What's wrong with my brain? I mean, I thought I could read, right? But I missed those Fs. You know, I thought I could count, but you know, that 5,000, it just came so easy. You know, duck, rabbit, dolphin, I thought I could see, but clearly there's something missing. And maybe my senses are messing with me a little bit, all right? Now, I want to teach you four things, and I want you to remember this forever. If you want to move into a space of excellence, understanding how your brain works, you want to remember and use these four things going forward forever. All right. So in the very first place, the first thing I want you to remember forever is that with the F's exercise, where most of you gave me twos and threes, I got a few fours, a couple of fives, there were a few sevens. I want you to remember forever, I do not see all there is to see. All right? I do not see all there is to see. This is a medical statement, by the way, a medical statement. If I had a week with you, I would often on the Wednesday bring, I've got these yoga blocks. I was just looking, maybe I could find one in this room. But I've got these yoga blocks, bright orange yoga blocks. And I will bring one of these orange yoga blocks to you and to the facility where I'm, you know, the venue, and I'll put it right here in front. And then he will stand there the whole Wednesday, the whole Thursday. On Friday lunchtime, I say, guys, I want to hand out some prizes. Any person that can find a bright orange object in this room, I'll give you a chocolate or something. Then adults, they crawl under tables. They look in other people's bags, but they will not see this bright orange object that I've just put in front of them for 2 days. Be standing there. And when I give them the magic word, they go like, it was not there. It was not there. And I'd be standing there for 2 days. I do not see all there is to see is a medical statement. I'm going to explain to you in a second why your brain is doing it. But there's so much around you right now, in your room, wherever you find yourself, and your physical things, but your brain will not allow you to see it. Now, I'll explain in a second why your brain is doing this, because people go, oh, goodness, this is unbelievable. I can't believe this. Well, you know what an F looks like, right? I mean, yeah, I gave you seven Fs and most of you didn't see it. So it seems like it is physically a physical thing. But once you get this, once you understand that your brain is doing this, it should change the way you go through life. Where have you given up on an idea or on a person or on a goal because you just couldn't see that this is working? And maybe the answer was like a big F this far from your nose on your screen, and you were looking at it and just couldn't see the answer. Once you get this concept, you should get out of bed differently in the morning. I get up in the morning and go like, where am I missing Fs? Where will I find Fs today? Oh man, they are all around me. I just don't see them. And that's okay. But once you get this concept, it should change the way you interact. Now, I don't know how it works in your industry. If you also do performance reviews and things like that, you know, that these big corporate guys that they do. But often when I had to go for a performance review, I would avoid that. I would hate that. You know, when my boss would say, Quibus, can you come to my office and let's talk a little bit about your performance, you know? So when you have time, come around. I'm like, maybe 2028, I've got some time. I'm just avoiding it at all cost, right? But once you get this, oh, man, you go and you say, I know I miss Fs. Show me where I'm missing Fs. Where am I missing it? I want to see more. We are all missing Fs. And when your colleague, your friend, your client, when they can't get whatever you want to give them through their thick skull, maybe it's not because they are stupid or trying to be different or anything. Maybe physically they just don't see what you are showing them. And it will become your job to make sure to help people find the F's that you can see. Does that make sense? Will you remember that forever? It should change the way you get up in the morning when you get to a space of, I do not see all there is to see. Now, with a 5,000, oh, I love that 5,000. Most of you gave me 5,000. I could see people changing the number a little bit later to 4,100. There were also a lot of 6,000s that I saw. Now, with a 5,000, oh, man. I in real life, in a live audience, much easier for me to get my whole audience giving me 5,000. But I've played with this morning. I said, hey, guys, we're going to do a little sum. And I just flashed my hand twice on the screen like this. Just twice. And I say, yeah, I'm going to show you what side of your brain. Just twice. And I know that if I can get your brain to make the number 5 important, your brain go like, oh, okay, we're gonna do a sum. I've got five. Let's go. And so the first thing I did is I just flashed my hand on the screen twice to see what will be the impact. And then I did a second thing. I said, you know what, this is like 1,000 plus 20, and I made the word 1,000 more dominant than the word 20 for your brain to go like, oh, I've got five, oh, and I've got a thousand, you know. And your brain started working out the sum before I even showed you the sum. Isn't that crazy? You are designed to be influenced. You are designed. I used to say we are designed to be brainwashed. And then somebody said that sounds illegal, Quibber. So I just changed it. Okay, then we are designed to be programmed. But you need to understand that our brain takes in information all the time and to try and make sense of it. And for many of you, more than half of you, I would say, what's out of your brain? I give you 5. I make the word 1,000 dominant. And your brains are thinking that you came up with the answer 5,000 when it was never your idea. It took me 16 seconds to put that number in your head. If I can do that in 16 seconds, what can a teacher do to a kid in school for a year? Or a boss to the employees at the workspace? Putting ideas in our heads, making us believe that is our thinking. Your design, when you get this, you go through life differently. Every time I switch on the radio, oh, this old country of ours, there's no hope. Yeah, people just flashing. We just go like, yeah, cool. I also thought that. We should become so, what's the word I'm looking for? You can go through life by default or by design. And when it comes to our thinking, we should choose design. We should decide what we want to do and where we want to stop listening to the world screaming at us. Oh, man, I wish I had a day with you, but I'm looking at the time. Duck and rabbit. Two people can look at the same thing and have different experiences. You need to know this. You need to absolutely know this. One person can look at something and say, this is a duck. And the other person will say, this is absolutely a rabbit, you know? And then in the business place, this person will say, this is a duck because my grandfather said it was a duck. My father said it was a duck. So therefore, it's a duck. And in this company, we will duck. And then the other person will say, you know what? I really think there's a rabbit there. And then this guy will say, if you say rabbit one more time, written warning, my friend, written warning. And then the other guy said, oh, okay. I see the duck. And then he said, okay, go and feed the duck. And then the rabbit dies at the end. You need to understand, once we get it, that we can physically look at the same thing and have different experiences, it should change the way we interact with each other. When you come into my office and say, Kurbus, I'm saying there's something I'm seeing, even if I don't see it after today, we will sit back and go, wow, I do not see what you see. I do not hear what you hear. But just because I don't see it and I don't hear it doesn't mean it's not there. Tell me again. Try to show me again I am open to listen and engage. And when you can click this, it turns you into a high performance person. And lastly, guys, curve cards. Seeing is not believing. If you come from our world of neuroscience and business, you will know that seeing is not believing. Our senses are messing with us. And I'm going to just give you in 7 minutes, I want to show you what part of your brain is doing this, is causing this. But before I do this, I want to give you a word. And this is the most important word that in life. You know, I always tell people, if you want to get a tattoo, this is the one. Go and get this tattoo. And the word is the word scotoma. Scotoma. Now, scotoma's got its origin in Greek, the Greek language, and scoto is like darkness, blindness, but scotoma is just a blind spot of the brain. That's what it is. Our brain have blind spots, and the word scotoma just describes that. And what you need to know is that you are full of scotomas. You need scotomas. We are all full of scotomas. Without this, we cannot live. But it's so important to know that I have them because it changes the way I interact with other people. Maybe the truth has always been the truth and nothing but the truth. Maybe there's a better truth. And instead of being so certain about this way of doing, maybe we can absolutely sit back after today and say, am I willing to explore a different way, a better way? Is there maybe a better truth out there that will be helpful for me? And I think if you just leave with that, that will be amazing. But I quickly want to show you what part of the brain is the part that just caused all of this. Do you see that purple bit over there in the middle? If you go from center down, you see that purple bit. We call that the reticular activating system, the RAS, all right? So whenever I meet you, you walk past me in the store, you say, hey, Quibbers, how's your RAS? Then I will know that you're talking about my brain and not a different part of my body. So the RAS, the RAS, is a filter. And what this filter does, it filters your senses all the time. It helps you to concentrate, right? So if you have to take in all the information through your senses all the time, your brain will bomb. It's too much. Just visually, you take in about 2 million bits of information per second. Your brain can only process 110 from the 200 million bits per second. So where does the other 1.9 million something goes? Well, you just don't see it. You just don't experience it. It is just not there. So your brain needs to do this to filter information so that you can get the right information at the right time to go through life. All right, so that's the function of it. When it thinks something is important to you, it will be interpreted by your brain. When it thinks it's not that important to you, it will literally block that signal to your brain. Let's take the olives, for example. When I say good morning, here's the sentence, finish files, find the F's in that sentence, and a lot of you gave me 2 and 3 F's, a very healthy brain, by the way, so you can go like, my brain is actually good. Because when you were young, and you went to grade 1, or I don't know when we learned to read, and the teacher said, good morning, class. He said, good morning, teacher. She said, today we're going to look at the letter F. And she wrote the big F on the board. And you said, F, teacher. And then she said, okay, say after me, fish. This is a F for fish. And you went, F for fish. All right. And when you said for fish, a neural pathway formed in your brain. It became a very dominant way. And the more you repeated the F sound, the more you like, okay, that is a for fish. And then she said, say after me, Freddy's fish got fried on Friday. And the more you engaged in that kind of, that is a for fish, the more the neural pathway formed. Now today, Quibbers comes along and I say, good morning, class, find the F's. And when I said find the F's, the reticular activating system said, okay, everything that looks like a F and sounds like a full fish, that is a F. And so you went finished, fish, yes. And the reticular activating system let it through. Files, yes. And it let it through. Of. It looks like an F, but it sounds like a V. And even though you are seeing it and the light comes in, reticular activating system says, I block the signal. I block the signal. And so the light comes in, you are reading the Rs, but it's not being interpreted. What else in your life is not being interpreted? Where else are you missing things in your life? Where else are you looking for the answer and you just can't see it? And it might be right there in front of you. Once you understand that this is happening, you should open yourself up and you should literally just start talking to people. Where am I missing Fs? Where am I missing Fs? I don't get the right answer. Come and help me. Who's finding more Fs? If you can do that, you will go through life so successful. But for some reason, we go through life thinking that we need to convince everybody else that we know it all. And that is keeping us stuck. That is keeping us stuck. If there's one thing that you can take from this and you can just get to a place of, I am missing Fs, and that's okay. That is good. Therefore, I need to surround me with people all around me. And by the way, when I see another person is missing Fs, it's maybe not because they are stubborn or stupid or doing things differently. It is literally just because the brain doesn't maybe allow to see it. And it becomes my job to come next to them and say, let me help you discover more Fs in your life. Oh man, if you can do that, you will become a magnet. You will become so attractive. People will storm to you to just be in your presence. Thank you for the opportunity. Love chatting to you. Oh man. Go well and just go and find the Fs out there. They're all around us. And by the way, figure out what excellence is, because when I get to my idea of what excellence is, my brain will then start showing me those Fs. It will say, this is important. And that's how I walk into that space of excellence. Bye, Dankie. Goodbye.
Kobus, thank you so much for spending some time with us here this morning and sharing with us your insights on the influence of neuroscience in thinking. That was truly fascinating. So usually at this time of the day, we have an address from the CEO of the Insurance Institute of South Africa, Thokozile, but she is not joining us today. We have a special surprise for you. It's almost time for the AIE, the African Insurance Exchange at Sun City towards the end of July. And the industry is about to descend on Sun City to go a network, grow their professional knowledge and base, and also just to have a little bit of fun. Now, the MC of this event is Tumela Mototwane, and she's going to give us a little bit of a little short message today to prepare everyone for AIE 2024. We hope you have an amazing time there. And I know that there are still seats available. So if you still want to go, you can make contact with the organizers and they will make sure that you have a seat at this very prestigious conference.
The 50th African Insurance Exchange, Africa's premier insurance conference, takes place online and at Sun City from the 21st to the 24th of July. Join me, Tumelo Mototwane, and the cream of the insurance sector as we explore the most topical issues faced by the industry in South Africa and around the world. There will also be plenty of time for networking and superb entertainment. For more details, visit www.africaninsuranceexchange.com. The African Insurance Exchange, bringing professionals together for 50 years.
Thank you.
Thank you, Tumelo. I'm sure there's great excitement, as I mentioned earlier on. But I want to touch on the issue around CPD points. So one of the big benefits also of attending the AIE is you get 16 CPD points for being at the conference, listening to very influential speakers, spending your time growing your professional knowledge and experience. But we often get questions here at InsureTalk about the CPD certificates and the CPD points. We're just into a new cycle now, so it's a good time to understand exactly how it works. At InsureTalk, if you attend this virtual conference, and you are an IISA member, we automatically upload your certificate to the IISA portal. So you don't have to wait for it. You don't have to ask for it. It sits there. When you log into your portal on the IISA, you will see your certificates there. If you're not a member, which I suggest you should change, because if you're in this industry, you should become a member of the Insurance Institute of South Africa. But if you're not a member, you can go to the InsureTalk website and make sure you log in with the same email address that you used to register for today's session. And then you will be able to find your CPD certificate there as well. So it all happens, you'll get it. It will come to you eventually. And we hope that that we see you here each month, because this is a great way for you to get your CPD points without it being too intrusive in your daily work life. Next up, we have Rianette Whitehead. She gives us, as per usual, a media update of what's happening in the news in the industry. And as we know by now, Rianette is the co-owner and the editor of FA News magazine, and she's also the founder of The Insurance Apprentice. So let's hear all about the news in our industry, Rianette Whitehead.
Good morning, InsureTalkers. Once again, thank you, CNCO and the team, for allowing us to share some of the news and exciting things happening in the industry. For those who do not know me, my name is Rianette Whitehead, and I'm the editor for FA News and also the founder of The Insurance Apprentice. I believe my lighter moments, i.e. jokes, in the last InsureTalk session were fairly well received. So unfortunately, I have to break the news to you that I don't have any of those today. So let's move over to the serious stuff. We've just been through a very interesting election. I think a bit more interesting than anyone anticipated. Some are shocked, some surprised. Others were set to disrupt whatever it is from the beginning, regardless of the results. And some are fairly content. It's an interesting time we're entering. And what is most certainly positive is that we are seeing a sense of optimism in the air. We all hope and pray that this election results could very well usher in a new era of stability and growth, particularly from an investment perspective. Political stability often brings with it investor confidence, and this could be a significant boom for our economy. For those of us in the insurance industry, this is particularly relevant because a stable political climate can lead to a more robust economic environment, which in turn can drive growth in our sector and obviously many other sectors, which all brings business back to the insurance sector. Now let's turn our attention to the current state of the insurance industry in South Africa. It's exciting times filled with innovation, challenges and opportunities. Firstly, the implementation of the two-pot retirement system is one of the most significant changes we've seen. It's not short-term specific, but I mentioned it last time and I feel it's important that we touch on it. We all will retire eventually, and you can make the wrong decision from now on going forward. So make sure you are just clued up on what this two-pot retirement system means. FA News will be doing a webinar in July sponsored by Old Mutual. So if you are keen and interested, attend the webinar and just hear what this buzz and hype is all about. Another major development is the increasing focus on technology and digital transformation within the industry. Companies are leveraging advanced technologies to streamline operation, enhance customer experience, and improve risk assessment processes. The use of AI and machine learning in underwriting and claims processing is becoming more prevalent. This not only increases efficiency, but also helps in providing personalized and accurate services to clients. Well, that is at least the intention. But, and it's a big but, we are reading and hearing about this the whole time. But after a recent conversation with a broker friend, I was a bit surprised about the state of claims, specifically personal lines. What our conversation was specifically about personal lines insurance. I'm not even talking about corporate and commercial. But it seems like the moment that claims get slightly complicated or slightly difficult, there's all kinds of issues coming in. It's also interesting to see how some of the insurers are fairly advanced in terms of the technology when it comes to claims, while others are far behind. I think there will be a bigger conversation from our side, so make sure you watch this space, because I think we need to share ideas and talk about things. On the topic of consumer needs, there's a growing emphasis also on mental health and resilience within the insurance sector. The importance of mental well-being has never been emphasized on this level. And insurers are most certainly responding by offering products and services that support mental health. This includes everything from providing access to counseling service to developing wellness programs that help clients build resilience. I think this topic is very relevant to mention today as it ties in well with our main speaker for the day. This is something we here at IFI News will most certainly also delve into a little bit more deeper going forward. I do remind you that the June IFI News June edition is live. You can read it and do your CPD hours. It's a phenomenal edition, packed with a variety of articles. There's something for everyone. We've done a summary on the webinar we've done on PI cover. We talk about the challenges in the construction industry. And interesting to mention, I was in George last weekend and decided to drive past collapsed building site just to find a small dam. The entire area is well underwater, not just water lying. Well underwater, which probably explains a few things. So we also touch on a few topics close to my heart: service, skills transfer, and the power of empathy in our industry. Hopefully we will be able to share some super exciting news around the Insurance Apprentice and our move to television in the next few weeks. This will speak to what we stand for even more. We stand our tagline is educate, elevate, empower, and this will most certainly take that conversation to the next level. In the next few weeks, I will also announce the fact that we will significantly increase the prize money for the winner for the next round. We are going big. So have a look out for that. And if that doesn't persuade you, not a lot will. Super excited to mention that we've recorded our first podcast. We call it TIA Talks, hosted by one of our top 10 contestants of this year's competition, and we will share that soon. So our aim is to really delve into topical industry issues. It's all about taking education inside and outside the industry to a new level. So make sure you follow TIA and IFI News on all our social platforms to make sure you don't miss out on some of the most exciting developments this industry has seen. Enough of us. Please enjoy the rest of your session and I'll see you soon.
Thank you, Rianette, friend of the Insure Talk. I always get the two confused. And as always, a very comprehensive update of what's going on in our industry. We appreciate all the effort you put into that. Now we've reached that time of the day again, where we get an opportunity to go and get some tea, coffee, or a glass of water, and be entertained by a local South African artist, which is something that we've done since the very first episode at Insure Talk. We've got Lukhanyiso Skosana, who is going to entertain us for the next 10 minutes. Thank you.
Salutations, beloveds. My name is Lukhanyiso Skosana. I am an award-winning interdisciplinary artist and creative consultant. I am very excited to be here with you guys on Insure Talk, and thank you and enjoy. Hey.
ndikufune esentlini nasezitratweni owesibhedlela nasetrongweni ondide ndikufuma
Thank you very much. The first song is titled The Way We Were by Barbra Streisand. The second song is titled Lakutshona Ilanga by the infamous Miriam Makeba. It has been a wonderful and an exciting experience here with you all at Insure Talk. I am Lukhanyiso Skhosana, signing out.
CNN Co. Events proudly brings you Insure Talk Live. The time has come to close your laptop and join us live. Network with industry leaders and influencers. Engage and learn from A-list speakers. Interact with top exhibitors. Experience the best live entertainment and so much more. Register today. Visit cnncoevents.com. Insure Talk Live, shaping the future together. Register today.
Well, next up, we have someone who's going to look into the future a little bit for us. Jaco Oosthuizen is going to talk on the topic of What is the insurance model of the future? I'm really, really interested to hear what this is about. Now, Jaco Oosthuizen is the co-founder and managing director of ULife South Africa. And before we get into his talk, I wanted to tell you a bit about Jaco. He began his career in the MMI group as an actuarial student and swiftly moved on to head up an actuarial valuations team within Momentum. Jaco then headed up the team that created and developed Momentum's Multiply Wellness program. We all know that program really well. And it's grown to be the second largest wellness rewards program in South Africa. So he's most interested in addressing the trust deficit in the insurance industry through client engagement and uncovering meaningful insights. Trust deficit, it's such a good way to describe it, Jaco. I always say grudge purchase, but trust deficit is definitely a little bit more elegant. So what is the insurance model of the future?
Thanks so much. Can everyone see my slides?
Yes, we can.
Okay. Yeah. Hi, everyone. And thanks for that introduction. What I want to focus on today, you know, is the insurance model of the future. It's been fascinating for me, you know, over time, just being in this insurance industry for so long. How we just continue doing the same thing and we try to, you know, think we can get different results. So I think, you know, just firstly, why does the insurance industry exist? We're all working in the insurance industry. It's a $6 trillion industry. And the idea really is around spreading of risk, you know, as we all know. But it remains a grudge purchase. You know, people don't wake up in the morning and say, you know, I would love to buy an insurance product that I would love to engage with my insurance company. And there's a lot of tech companies that now comes through. And the first thing you look on your phone in the mornings, you know, is you look at an app that you engage with on a regular basis. But insurance is definitely not like that at the moment, you know. So if I look at the history of insurance, the first insurance sort of policy that we know of or insurance that was 1750 before BC, you know, where the Babylonians actually started to insure their ships, you know. So, and then in medieval Europe is really, and that is what this picture sort of depicts, is where insurance really started, you know, with craftsmen in Europe that their houses burned down, and then, you know, there were guilds that were being formed and insurance funds created to protect them. And actually, when their houses burned down, that there was money available to restart their businesses. And then really the shipping industry, and that's where Lloyd's of London started in the 1600s, you know, where Lloyd's emerged, and actually the underwriting of cargo and etc. And it's actually very interesting. The first life insurance policy was issued in 1583, but there was a huge lack at that stage to understand mortality and so on. So people made a lot of losses and underwriting losses there. And then Edmund Halley, you know, from Halley's Comet, he was the first person actually that designed mortality tables and started to price risk, you know, properly. But it's also very interesting that a lot of the policy wording that we have now is over 200 years old, you know. So there's a lot of things that haven't changed really in the insurance industry over a very long, long period. So, you know, in our view, you know, what has gone wrong is I think a lot of us, we understand risk and probabilities, you know, but do we really understand the end client needs and how that has changed over the last few years? I mean, if I just look at, you know, since I started as an actuarial student in 91, you know, we still had, you know, there weren't mobile phones around. We still had fax machines. You know, I still programmed in Fortran on mainframes with tapes and floppy disks, etc. You know, and we actually did a lot of I started in defined benefit valuations, you know, and all of those were in big files and written down. And now everything that we have is on this phone, you know, but have we as an industry really, you know, adjusted to that? We also, I mean, insurance is typically a black box that people don't understand. There's a lot of mis-selling happening, and the regulations really had to force us, you know, to try to focus on the end consumer and treating customers fairly. And technology has now enabled a lot of things and data. And I think a lot of insurers haven't really, you know, caught up with technology. And insurance is still, it's a very boring subject, you know. People, when the new Apple phone comes out, people stand in queues to get it, you know. People don't stand in queues to get their insurance policy. So, and also the daily engagement on insurance is very low. So, I mean, there's literally 0%. You maybe get one or two communications from your insurance company on an annual basis. It's one of the least trusted, industries around. And there's also a huge focus, you know, that we need to start on prevention instead of just, you know, paying out when claims and something wrong happens. But how can we actually start to manage risk and prevention? And there's also, we now have so much data available, you know, I think in all sectors of insurance, from short-term insurance, life insurance, et cetera. And how do we start to play a different role in the lives of the end consumer? So I want to talk about three problems. The first problem is insurance is not fun. You know, it's a very, very functional. A lot of the apps and the engagement, you know, it's like I got my tax statements now from my insurance companies and so on. But it's very functional things, you know, that you do on apps and insurance websites and so on. So it's very logical, you know, but it's not attractive. It's not like something that people want to wake up, you know, like really engage, and it's not fun and interactive. So, for example, on our app that we developed, we get about 45% of people using the app on a daily basis, you know. And so it's the most highly engaged insurance app globally. And that's really what one of the purposes of ULife is. We want to change the way that people engage with their insurance company. And that is the second problem, you know, is that we have this low engagement, you know, people don't trust us, there's a fear, there's complexity, and how do we make it simple for the end user to actually understand their insurance policy, but also then give them value on a daily basis and not just, you know, when something bad happens. And we also stuck in the dark ages. I mean, a lot of the, I worked in the UK for a while, and some of the oldest insurance companies there are over 300 years old, you know. So there's a huge gap and a huge amount of legacy systems, and obviously through mergers and acquisitions, et cetera, that happened over time. And we haven't really adopted to this digital age. Obviously, COVID has now helped, you know, a lot of people to move to digital. And for example, you know, if you think about the history of Kodak, you know, Kodak was the company that first invented the digital camera, but they don't exist anymore because they didn't actually adapt to the changes in technology. And we know as insurance, the industry that, what we need to do, but do we have that willpower to do it? Otherwise we will die. There's a lot of new tech companies. I think like ULife is now rated one of the top 100 insurtechs globally, you know, and I think there's a lot of insurtechs now that are starting to, you know, take over from where some of the large insurers are not keeping up to the pace. So how can we think differently? So firstly, you know, if you look just at insurance claims, you know, one out of 1,000 people really benefit from, from that more or less, you know, if we look at life insurance, if early intervention, maybe 2 out of 100 really engage with that. Self-motivated well-being tools is 2 out of 10. But we need to get to a place where the whole population starts to engage and where there's, you know, everyone actually starts to understand fully and engage with their insurance company on a daily basis. At ULife, we really believe in small steps, you know, so a lot of programs out in the market, you know, think you need to, you know, get to the top status and it's very exclusive and so on. But for us, it's about, you know, if you look at the book Atomic Habits, you know, it's about small changes and making, which can make a big change, a difference in people's lives. You don't need to run marathons. You don't need to be super athlete, you know, but how do we get people just to take that first step in terms of their own wellness and prevention? So we need to create an insurance model of the future. You know? And so what we are looking at is, you know, at the moment, a lot of the products that we have is the I win, you lose type of situation. But we need to create a win-win, you know, where everyone wins. The employer wins, the insurer wins, the end consumer wins. Society at the whole actually needs to benefit from what we are bringing to the market and producing. So really creating this win-win economics, and building trust and sustainability as well. You know, ESG is a big thing as well that we are focusing on, and really helping people to understand and create, like, you know, because a lot of people, I think, they don't trust the industry because they it feels like this black box and they don't really know what's going on, and claims sometimes don't get paid, etc. So how do we get people to fully understand and engage with their insurer? So I think the first focus for us really is on prevention. And if you look at prevention, you know, you need to have the ability and the motivation. So we looked at, when we designed our app, we looked at games and gamification, and you know, got some of the if you look, for example, at this the most engaging fitness app ever in the world was Pokemon Go. And Pokemon Go, for example, never told you need to walk. You know, you just had to go and pick up, you know, these virtual augmented reality characters in different locations, but it never said you must walk. And everyone actually got a lot more engaged. And this is still one of the top 10 highest, you know, apps, usage apps in the world. The second thing, you know, is to prioritize feeling over function, you know, that people create a real feeling that they are engaging with their insurance company. And there's people are different, are inspired and motivated by different things, you know. So some of us love rugby or comedy, etc. And sometimes, you know, even if you look at your rugby team, you get so excited and inspired, and you're not even playing with them, you know, and you feel it's us actually participating. So how do you make your customers feel that they are actually part of your business and inspired to, you know, buy what you are providing? And it's not just the function of, you know, app that they or engagement that they are getting. And other people, you know, like cycling, other yoga, et cetera. So how do we also start to personalize this feeling that we are creating with our customers? You know, our CTO, Josh Hart, said this, that emotions could be the difference between a good insurance product and a great one. And so when we developed the app, we looked at, you know, what do people really do on their mobile phones? And a lot of them play games. I've got a few games here. Candy Crush is one of my best ones, and I've got Golf Clash here, and there's this new thing called Royal Match, you know, which I really like. But when we designed our app, we got a consultant in that designed Candy Crush. We thought, okay, how can we use this addictive sort of behavior that people have with games to get them to live a healthy lifestyle? So we designed our app around that and getting huge engagement, you know, with currently South Africa, the download rate of your app is over 80%. One of the recent large retailers, you know, is already on 51% download rate, and then we get very high engagement. In the app, you can actually see your policy documents, and all in a very gamified and a fun way that people come to on a very regular basis. The third thing I want to talk about is just embrace world-class tech, you know. So insurance historically has been a big, you know, black box. It's something that's not sold. And if you look at Apple, you know, I've got everything is Apple. I've got Apple, you know, laptop. I've got the Apple phone, and everything is integrated. And how can we start to create this sort of seamless client experience, you know, from end to end? And I think particularly like in the group risk market, if I look at globally, you know, UK, South Africa, etc., there's just so many manual processes, you know, all the way from, you know, the quotes process, the onboarding process, the underwriting, claims, etc., you know. So we've also now created locally a system that everything is sort of in one place, and trying to just streamline that there's no disconnect in the process, and also the onboarding that we've created. And also we need to start to think about ecosystems. You know, I think a lot of us want to always do it ourselves, you know, when you know, in some of the big companies I've worked for, you know, like IT is centralized and everything is centralized and everyone thinks that they can do it better, but there's a lot of tech companies out there that can potentially help you to create an ecosystem that will give you a much better client experience overall. So I think we really need to look very differently about how do we develop and how do we, you know, create these client experiences. We don't necessarily have to do it ourselves, because there's so much skills available out there. So yeah, what insurance was, I mean, as I said, I think like 20, 30 years ago, you know, I got my first laptops, and I remember, still remember, we had these brown files and client letters, and you know, then emails and mobile phones came out, and the internet, you know, sort of revolutionized it, and we had mainframes. And I think, you know, a lot of companies are still working on green screens, for example, and AS400s, and you know, and I remember just how difficult it was to create, you know, data warehouses and business intelligence. You know, now wearables and data is available for everyone to use, and I can still remember in 2008, for example, we launched the first USB downloadable pedometers that we sent to clients, and we still had to put a CD-ROM and send that to clients and so on. And now it's like 15 years later, and everything is just, all the data is just available, integrated. Are we actually using it? Insurance companies are sitting on so much data, but are we really using that efficiently for the benefit of the end consumer and creating something that would look more like this, you know, where it's a fun experience for people to engage with us, that they fully understand, you know, that insurance is thought to be bought and not just sold, creating an ecosystems platform economy. You know, if you look at Amazon, for example, they don't stock all their products, you know, so why do we also always have to create our own products? Why can't we just, you know, tap into ecosystems and create the best experience for clients? So I think that is, you know, sort of my story. I know it was a quick, but, you know, at ULife, we do not just sell insurance, but we really want to inspire people on a daily basis to live their best lives. And that is the end of my presentation.
Jaco, thank you again for joining us today, co-founder and MD of ULife South Africa. We have reached almost the end of today's program, and we end on a high note. So I mentioned earlier that Elite is our event headline sponsor, but we also have another sponsor today with Global Choices. And Global Choices is specifically our event partner, and they have brought us a fantastic speaker for today. You might know him, Stephen McGowan. He's a motivational speaker. And in addition to bringing the speaker to us today, Global Choices would also like to give away 3 copies of Stephen's book to the InsureTalk attendees. So you have to be here today to be able to get a copy of this book. The book is, if you don't know who Stephen is, the book is 6 years with Al-Qaeda, the Stephen McGowan story. And we are going to ask you a question. I am going to ask you a question, and we ask you to pop the answer in the chat box. And then afterwards, we will do a lucky draw. So in order for you to win a copy of 1 of 3 copies sponsored by Global Choices, 6 years with Al-Qaeda, we ask that you answer the following question. What is your key takeout of Stephen's journey? And how can it apply to your personal or professional life, especially in the context of the insurance industry? Please pop your answers in the comment section in the chat box. And the topic of Stephen's address today is freedom is an attitude. Let's hear all about it. Thank you, Stephen. And just like that, we've reached the end of today's insert of Insure Talk. That was a fantastic delivery and gives you a lot to think about, you know, when we consider our own struggles in life, what someone, for instance, like Stephen has managed to overcome and endure. So a few things I want to leave with you. The book, the winners, the 3 winners of the book will be contacted after the show by Global Choices, the sponsor of this our event partner for today, and the sponsor of this motivational talk that we received today. So I expect to hear from the Global Choices team if you were a winner. We want to thank Elite again, Tarina and your team. We really appreciate your support here at InsureTalk and at CNN Co Events. Thank you again, Old Mutual Insure. And then I want to just share something very exciting with you. September is InsureTalk Live again. We did it last year. We only have 100 spots open for people to attend in person. It's on the CNN Co Events website. It's on the InsureTalk website. You can go and register and book your spot. Bring your staff. Come and engage with us in person. It was a huge success last year. And we want to build on that foundation of the very first InsureTalk event in 2023 and do it again and even better this year. So it's in September. You can go and book just 100 people in person. The rest will be online. So InsureTalk will still carry on as usual, but some few lucky individuals, if they move quickly enough, will actually be able to meet with us in person in Johannesburg. So please do join us. And on that note, I would like to say goodbye. I see you again next month, and we really appreciate you joining us here today. Thank you.